funeral service. In celebration of Gwen's life. Before we do so, now's the opportunity, if we have a mobile phone or if you've got mobile phones, just to make sure they're turned off or in a silent position. Because over the next 40 minutes or so is the time when we don't need to be connected to the outside world. Because we're all drawn here because this lady has been indeed more than just a significant part in your lives.
Good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of Neil, Greg, Gavin and their families, I'd like to welcome you all to this memorial service for Gwen, whose mortal body was laid to rest in the Port Victoria Cemetery this morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is David Amory, and I'm a retired Anglican priest living in Port Victoria. In the time that I have been living here, it has been a great pleasure for both myself and Corrie, my wife, to be welcomed into the Twelftree family. Everything you need to know about the service and to follow is included in the booklet provided. Music was very much a part of Gwen's life. And she would be more than just pleased to know that family friend of many years, Peter Holmes, is here to play today. You will note that the three chosen hymns each have only three verses. And some of you who will know your hymn books very well will know that at least two of those hymns have far more than three verses. It was Gwen's specific wish that only three verses were to be played at this service. So please sing with gusto. As I said, music was very much a part of Gwen's life. A few years back, I brought Father Hilary Minmin, an Anglican priest from Myanmar and a highly accomplished musician, to meet Neil and Gwen. As we walked into the lounge room, Hilary's eyes lit up and he asked if it would be possible to play the organ. With light in her eyes, Gwen was happy to oblige and Hilary played. Each year on our return to Myanmar, Hilary asked after Neil and Gwen. I informed him of Gwen's death, and he asked me to assure Neil and the family that he would pray for them and for the repose of her soul. Yesterday, when I spoke to Hilary, he said to me, "Is Neil still driving?" Of course, I said. He was suitably amazed. Grace and peace from the Lord be with you. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet will they live. As we come forth naked from our mother's womb, so shall we go again, naked as we came. We shall take nothing for our toil, which we may carry away. This also is a grievous ill. Just as we came, so shall we go. Let us pray together. Loving God, you alone are the source of life. May your life-giving spirit flow through us and fill us with compassion one for another. In our sorrow, give us the calm of your peace. Kindle our hope and let our grief give way to joy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now I invite you to stand as able, and we'll sing together the first hymn, How Great Thou Art.
Oh, this is a big one. I apologise now should errors in spelling or grammar occur. Also, any facts I have misconstrued. Gwendolyn Lewis May was born at Carmichael Private Hospital on the 6th of June 1928 to Albert and Doris May, the youngest sibling to Sister Erica. Gwen had a very happy family life on the May family farm. Of the early years, Gwen wrote, I love to play with all my dolls and Billy, my teddy, who happens to be here today. I'd also had tea parties with my imaginary husband, Ken. Life was good. Gwen and Erica attended Carmichael Primary School and were members of the local Brownie and Guide Packs. They enjoyed going to the local football with their dad, especially when the home team played the team from Point Pierce. On school days, the girls would have to walk a mile to school and home again. This continued for 3 years until their father bought them bicycles to ride, which Gwen described as a real pleasure, even though the road was rough and they always had a load of books, mail and papers on their cases after school for their mum and neighbours. Gwen attended Methodist Ladies College in Adelaide during her secondary years, but had to wait to start until Erica finished her schooling there because Albert would not buy a second set of uniforms, including the summer straw hat that Erica had got wet and was all out of shape. Life was busy at MLC as it was wartime and manpower scarce, so the students all had extra duties, cooking and housework in the boarding house. Gwen's best friend was Lois Murdoch, and Gwen wrote, and I quote, a lovely girl who always had plenty of money. Her parents were from a rich family in Wauru. Gwen returned home in 1942 to work with her parents on the farm. Erica worked at the Bank of Adelaide in Carmichael, but always helped Gwen with the milking and other chores each evening. Gwen also helped her mum, who was very fussy, with house chores, as well as entertaining local ladies with lavish afternoon teas, with all the food cooked on the big old wood stove. Sunday was always a busy family day, with car washing and shoe cleaning, etc. in the morning, and after a hot roast lunch, off to Sunday school, followed by a church service in the local Methodist church. Gwen taught Sunday school for several years, the tasks she loved to do, and she and Erica were also in the choir. The next chapter is an excerpt from Gwen's book. Erica and I always went to balls, mostly on Wednesday nights. We all had so many friends, girls and boys. A carload of us would often go to dances at Minutton and Moorooka and other towns. I was friendly with Bob Hughes at Adrossan. He played the piano beautifully. He thought we were too young to stay together. I had lots of other boyfriends, then met Neil at a ball at Minutton. He took me to the car and put my evening bag in his pocket so we could cuddle up. And he went home with it, so we had to post it back. That was the start of our romance. How wonderful. Neil played cricket and football, and I played tennis and basketball. We went to lots of functions and had a great time. Gwen and Neil's love for each other blossomed and grew. One young fun Carmichael told Gwen that she shouldn't marry the rough lad from royalty, but the marriage proposal was asked and accepted. Neil then promised Gwen he would build her a new home on the family farm at Royalty. In 1950, prior to their marriage, the following year, the building commenced on the new home. Gwen wrote, it was a lovely home and we gradually improved the garden, did cement paths and back fence. Then later a lovely front wall, lawn and rose garden. The front garden was my pride and joy. Gwen and Neil were married at St. Peter's College Chapel in Adelaide on a very hot day, 102 degrees, on the 3rd of February 1951. They spent three idyllic weeks honeymooning in the southeast, spending part of the time with Neil's cousins. Gwen wrote that Neil even shore a sheep. So romantic. Moving into the new farmhouse soon after returning home, they began what was to become an almost 70-year partnership. A wonderful marriage, built on love and respect that never faltered. Gwen and Neil settled into married life on the farm, working together to grow their holding. Gwen's farm jobs included milking cows, separating the milk, collecting eggs and feeding the pigs. She supported Neil during her whole time on the farm to help make it prosper and to pass on a wonderful legacy to the lead children. Sunbury was born on February 23, 1952, and the following year Gavin was born on August 12. Life was good, wrote Gwen. Farm life was the priority, but buying a caravan allowed for family holidays each year at the beach. In 1976, Gwen and Neil had an overseas holiday in Singapore, staying with Neil's cousin Jack and wife Mel, an experience of a lifetime. In later years, they also enjoyed holidays throughout South. In the early years, visiting friends and neighbours and playing tennis for Urania and Royalty, always with Greg and Gavin with her, were pastimes Gwen really enjoyed. Bowls at Cook Victoria was taken up after tennis, and Gwen and Neil enjoyed many years playing in local competitions and tournaments. Breeding and showing poultry was a pastime of Papa Twelftree. Gwen, Neil and the boys continued the tradition, and in 1967, Gwen entered a bird in the Royal Adelaide Show. She was delighted when said bird won champion young light cock. A very proud moment. Gwen joined and was confirmed in the Anglican Church early in her married life, and she, Neil and the boys attended St Albans at Port Victoria. She became an organist and played at weddings and funerals, including at St Pierce and every Sunday at regular services. Gwen continued to play the organ all her married life, a job she enjoyed, a wonderful achievement. After Greg and Gavin completed their schooling in Adelaide, they both came home to begin farming with Neil. Gwen loved that her sons, and now grandsons, Chad and Todd, continue the tradition that she was an important part of for so many years. Farm and family continued to grow. Gavin and Dick were married in 1976, and first grandchild, Melissa, arrived, followed by Chad 2 years later. Greg and Sue married in 1978 and gave Gwen and Neil 3 more grandchildren, Abby, Todd and Nicholas. Gwen was devoted to her growing family and was blessed with 11 great-grandchildren in recent years. Neil and Gwen built and moved into a new home in Port Victoria in 1980, where their retirement years began. However, life for Gwen was to take a difficult turn in January 1983, aged just 54, when she suffered her near-fatal heart attack while in Adelaide. She survived and received a triple bypass operation in the April, and so began an extended recovery. With Neil's love and encouragement, life gradually returned to normal. For the next 38 years, Gwen and Neil enjoyed attending local sports, community events, horse racing, and sharing time with family and friends. Neil spent much of his time fishing, and Gwen would stay in touch using the UHF radio, entertaining not only family, but anyone on Channel 25, as she would call 7 times a day wanting to know how the fishing was going and telling Neil about her day. Gwen really enjoyed being in their garden and particularly loved the roses she grew. Gwen was also very proud of her sons' and granddaughters' achievements in sport and at school. Birthdays, Christmas, and time spent with sister Erica and her husband David and 5 nieces, and any family celebration gave her great pleasure. We loved to stay in touch with family, particularly the grandchildren as they grew and flew the nest. Family was everything to Gwen, and it gave her great joy to know we were all happy and settled. I've also got some thoughts from Gavin, myself, and our children. From Gavin. Mum always greeted us with a smile and a cheek ready to be kissed, and always asked how our family was and what was happening in their lives, no matter how often we saw or spoke with you. Your home was open and welcome to everyone that called. When asked to help out, the answer was yes. Mum, your love for Dad and all the family will be everlasting. And from me, Gwenny, over 50 years, you were firstly my boyfriend's mother, and then you became my mum-in-law, nana to our children and grandchildren. We have shared a wonderful family life together, the happy and the sad times and everything in between. I will miss you, your friendship and your love. And from our children, Melissa, who's now with Stanley, and Jemima, Kayla and Emily, their 3 daughters. To some of you, she was Gwen, mum, aunt Gwen, or even Mrs. Twelftree. To Telstra, she was their best customer, but to the five of us, she was just Nana, a loving grandparent who regularly called to say hello, asking many questions, some of them unbelievable, and just to make sure we were okay. That's who Nana was to us. Never a birthday miss, a guarantee that serviettes were on the top of her Christmas shopping list. That's who Nana was to us. The girls could always count on Nana to ring the night before each school term started, making sure they polished their shoes and their pencils are sharp. That's who Nana was to us. Always looking her best and greeting with a kiss, proud of all her family and never missing a photo opportunity. That's who Nana was to us. Thanks for caring and for trying to teach us some lady manners. And finally, you, Nana, I'll always make sure the girls' shoes are polished, their pencils are sharpened, and their friends are nice. And from Chad and Michelle, Freya and Kirby, I feel privileged to, and this is Chad's words, I feel privileged to live my whole life where Nana Gwen was raised at Karamalka, and now to be getting our children, Freya and Kirby, the same farming upbringing that we have been blessed with. Although some of Nana's questions were not always appreciated, I know they came from the right place. Dr. Ma and his team, who will always hold a special place in our hearts for performing life-extending surgery on our Nana and allowing us to be given 37 years of unconditional love that she was able to give us. I can only hope to replicate your kindness and honesty. Our children have been extremely fortunate to have a great Nana, one we will never forget.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to. I'm going to first read some tribute from my children, our children. First of all, from Abby. You radiated a love for life, always smiling and kind, never a bad word spoken. I cherished our phone calls and loved how you always inquired about everyone's well-being. Your constant support, no matter where I lived, what I did, unconditional love and acceptance. Your love for all eight of us has meant more to me than I can express. You were the most elegant, graceful Nana. You taught us manners, kindness, and generosity. Our hearts are broken, but we can't complain. You lived a wonderful, almost 92 years, with the love of your life by your side for 70. You left the world peacefully with family surrounding you. We are grateful. Thank you for being our Nana. We will love you forever. And this one's from Todd. We were so lucky to have your love, care and support for so many years. You never missed a birthday and loved watching us play sports. I miss sitting and chatting with you or watching the action on the oval. So many treasured memories, playing quoits, snakes and ladders and table tennis. I remember snacking on your cheese platters while drinking Pa's home brew. You had an incredible memory and we loved hearing the old stories from back in the days at Karamalka. Your sweet personality was infectious. You taught us to be kind and always show an interest in others, as you did so well. Scrapbooking was one of your favourite hobbies, keeping newspaper clippings, cuttings of all the family's highlights. We feel blessed to live in the home that you and Pa built on the farm in 1950. The walls could tell some great stories and fond memories, with plenty more new ones to come. Rachel and I know you will be watching over our little bundle when it arrives in the next few weeks. Until we meet again, we will miss you, Nan. And I've got Rachel here on my phone. If you bear with me, here we go. This is from Rachel. I remember the first time Todd invited me to an event on the York Peninsula and how nervous he was to introduce me to Gwen and Neil. It was apparent that the connection he had with his Nan and Pa was strong. I will always remember my first dinner at Gwen and Neil's, a feeling of warmth and familiarity, a feeling I haven't felt since the times at my own grandparents' home. I remember thinking how lucky I was to have that again. Gwen embraced me from the first day I met her and made me feel a part of the family very early on. I will miss our chats together at the table and the stories she told of her life. She was always pleased to see us and filled the air with love wherever she was. That love won't go. We will always remember her sweet smile and beautiful nature. Rest peacefully, Gwen. And Nicolodi sent one from Darwin. Nana, the harbour master. She had unconditional love for our family, even when we were in trouble or made questionable hair or lifestyle choices. Sneaky lollies in church and lunches at footy out of the boot of the car are memories of childhood I will cherish. But it was when I started my own family that I fully appreciated the lady Nana was. Genuine interest in in-laws, friends, and our work was a trademark. I have so many friends that have stories about Nana, it's hard to grasp the impact Nana had on so many. It was also natural for her. Her presentation is something we all remember. Picture perfect for every photo, and just as elegant looking through the binoculars of the comings and goings, the Port Vic boat ramp, through the curtains of Nana and Pa's. Nana, we love you with all the love in the world. Nicholas, Renee, Murphy and Dottie. And I've got one now. And I will, before I start this, I will say thank you to David for officiating today. He's been a really good friend for Mum and Dad, and for me too. And for Pete here, I haven't seen him for a while. And we struggled with the music about an hour and a half ago, didn't we, Pete? I didn't want When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, but he seemed keen to play that one, didn't you, Pete? On behalf of Dad and his extended family, I'd like to thank you all very much for being here today. I've done that, and I'd particularly like to say thank you to my daughter Abby for being with Dad since last Monday week ago. She's been really, really helpful to Dad, and they've had so many good times together. Mum, Dad and I were watching television a few months ago, and the program was Keeping Up Appearances. Dad and I would occasionally liken Mum to Hyacinth Bouquet. I'm nothing like her, she'd say. Well, no, Mum, no, you don't look like her and you're not as big as her, but there are times when you tend to think it is all about you. That's certainly not the case, she said sternly. Well, today, Mum, it is all about you. I've been lucky to have been living in Port Vic here for 8 years, and this has enabled me to spend more time with Mum and Dad. I became an ambulance volunteer 7 years ago, and Mum loved having her odds taken. And sometimes I had to lie a bit to make her feel better. She was so conscientious with her fitness and her diet. Her health, though, has been up and down over the past couple of years in particular. I sat with Mum at the dining room table a couple of years ago. We'd finished tea and Dad had gone to sit on his recliner to watch Hogan's Heroes, which is a regular event. We were having a healthy discussion on what the kids and grandies were up to, and Mum was getting quite philosophical about her own life. I asked her what she thought about dying. And I thought she'd say, well, I've had a good life, etc., etc. She surprised me by saying, well, I'm not looking forward to it. I thought that was terrific. I gave her a high five, actually, and told her, well, the will to live and your health are the most important things in extending a life. And she was keen to keep going. A lot has been said about you today, Mum. You've been such a wonderful mother to Sue and me, a beautiful, kind, loving lady and so concerned for others. In fact, you loved everyone. And of course, she was always so elegantly presented. She was mortified when she was told she was too old for fashions on the field when she turned 80. I thank Dad for his part in Mum's life. He is truly amazing, a wonderful cook. He's terrific in the house, and Mum really appreciated him, and Gavin and I did too. When they both decided to stop playing pennant bowls soon after Mum's heart operation, it was a huge decision. They had both recently been bowling club presidents and loved the game, but it was clear Mum's health would suffer if she continued, particularly on hot days. But she was keen for Dad to keep playing, but no, he decided to stop too, and they decided to join the SAJC. They both loved the racing scene, attending 7 Melbourne Cups, a trip to Rose Hill, and numerous trips to Balaclava, Victoria Park, Morphettville Gawler, KIA and Port Lincoln, and they made many friends. Mum's Christian faith was extremely important to her, and she has been, as Diff said, the organist at St Albans for many years. And even when she last played, Dad would still have to give her the signal for the last verse, as he did all those 45 years. Mum went into hospital on Tuesday, the 19th of May, but it wasn't until Friday of that week that we all realised she wouldn't be going home. Monday the 25th turned out to be an amazingly significant day. At 6:30 in the morning, Nicholas and Renee made a FaceTime call from Darwin with the news they had a baby girl, soon to be named Dottie Gwendolyn. Later that morning, Dad, Gavin and I were all with Mum. Just before she passed away, she gave my hand a tight squeeze. It was a special moment I will cherish forever. Thank you.
Slides.
Well, wasn't that a gathering? I'm now going to ask the two readers to come forward. The two readings chosen today, one from Ecclesiastes and one from 1 Corinthians, all about love.
Time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give something up as lost, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to rip and a time to sow, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace.
My reading is from the first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 4 to 8 and 13. Love is patient, love is kind. It is not envious, love does not brag. It is not puffed up. It is not rude, it is not self-serving. It is not easily angered or resentful. It is not glad about injustice, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes in all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But if there are prophecies, they will be set aside. If there are tongues, they will cease. If there is knowledge, it will be set aside. For now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. It has been my very great pleasure over these past years to get to know Gwen and to be welcomed together with Neil, of course, into their home and family. Gwen lived a long life, and perhaps the great affirmation of longevity is that many people remember you. And I'm sure that is true with regard to Gwen. Kathleen Dowling Singh, in her book, The Grace in Dying, addresses the question as to why we fear death. It's a question that all of us must face. Singh's answer to this question concerning death is that we fear nothingness. And that, she says, is why we fear death. Death, says Singh, is the shocking realization that everything I thought was me, everything I held onto so desperately, was finally nothing. For me, the very interesting thing is that I find very few elderly people actually feel the way that Singh describes. And I have tried to reflect on just why this should be so. The answer, at least in part, I'm sure, can be related to the message from Ecclesiastes. Gwendolyn Doris Twelftree lived a long life. Some might say a very long life. And if we look back over those years of her life, we will discover that she must have seen many things. The contrast between the good and the not so good times here on York Peninsula and elsewhere, very much a part of her life. And while it's true that Gwen, like us, would no doubt have wished that there wasn't a time for weeping, and a time for mourning, that there was never a time for war or a time to hate. The fact is that this was all small part of what she experienced, and we likewise experience in our world. If we are honest about it, as I'm sure Gwen would have been, we know that by listing these times out, as Ecclesiastes does, allows us to find meaning in the difficult times as well as the joys. The message from Ecclesiastes is that when we accept that there are two sides to everything, then we are able to accept that this is a part of the world that we live in, and as a consequence, find the strength that helps us to move forward, such that we remember God, not just in times of need, but also, and perhaps more importantly, when everything is going well. Friends, it often seems to me that when everything is going well, in those times of joy and dancing and laughter, we often forget about God and we rely on ourselves just a bit too much. As a consequence, we begin to believe that all our fortunes are of our own making. And then when the opposite happens, we go through a long time of mourning and we look around and wonder if normality will ever be restored. Times like this are referred to by St. John of the Cross as a dark night of the soul, times when God seems distant and our prayers become dry, if not impossible. I'm sure that Gwen, like all of us, experienced at some time that dark night of the soul. But equally, I'm sure that she also, through her faith, through her receiving of nourishment through the sacraments, learned that she was never abandoned by her Lord and Saviour, whom she loved and who most certainly loved her. And so I return to where I started, to nothingness. Father Richard Rohr, that great Franciscan scholar, writes, "The nothingness we fear so much is in fact the treasure and freedom that we long for, which is revealed in the joy and the glory of the risen Christ. We long for the space where there is nothing to prove and nothing to protect, where I am who I am, in the mind and heart of God, and that is more than enough." And friends, perhaps that's the great secret that the very early hold and offer to us, if only we are willing to listen. So today we bid farewell to a faithful follower of our Lord Jesus. And we commend Gwen to God, who promised a great eternity to her and to each one of us in the fullness of time. Amen. We will now stand to sing the second hymn, "Ode for a Closer Walk with God." pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised Jesus Christ from the dead for the salvation of all. Gracious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you that you received Gwen by baptism into the family of your church on earth and granted her the gift of eternal life. She ate with us from the bread of life and drank from the cup of salvation. We thank you for all your goodness to Gwen in Christ our Saviour. Amen. Now let us pray for those who mourn. Merciful God, we pray for Neil, Greg, Gavin, and all the family whose sense of loss is so keen. When we cannot understand the things that happen and are weighed down by grief and loneliness, uphold us in your love. Give us the assurance of your constant care, that we may have courage for the days ahead through Jesus Christ, our friend. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray together that most radical prayer that our Lord himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now let us entrust our sister Gwen to the mercy of God, praying together. Holy and loving Father, by your mighty power you gave us life, and in your love you have given us new life in Christ Jesus. We entrust Gwen to your merciful keeping in the faith of Jesus Christ, who died and rose again to save us, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in glory forever. Amen. Rest eternal grant her, Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon her. We will now stand to sing that wonderful hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. And afterwards, if you remain standing for the final blessing and dismissal.
Thank you. blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and those you love, this day and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Please be seated.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're drawing to a close at Gwen's funeral service here this afternoon. I've got a basket of flowers here. We have the flowers that were laid on top of her coffin this morning. She was laid to rest in Twelftree Glory Cemetery. You're welcome to come forward to take a flower, to pause and place it in front of her casket's grave. And as you do so, it's a time when you might like to just quietly give thanks that she was a part of your life and you also a part of hers. From our time here, you're invited to just move through to the adjoining supper room and partake in some refreshments and remember to share your stories. We've just heard a snippet of some of them here this afternoon. We all have stories and memories of this wonderful lady who was part of our community here.